Hello, everyone. I hope you're doing well. Today, I'd like to address the insidious argument that all disadvantages men face result from male privilege or patriarchy backfiring on men. It's an argument mostly used by intersectional feminists, referred to as social justice warriors, but I guess if you ask the general public, they will also give you some version of this as an answer. I have always found that argument void of any logic, and I think this perfectly comes to light in regards to military service or draft registration. On February 22nd, 2019, it was announced that the male-only selective service registration in the United States is unconstitutional. I was notified by Mark Angelucci from the National Coalition for Men. He's the lawyer who won the case. Thank you, Mr. Angelucci. This victory was long overdue and long time coming. The next day, Monday, this news was all over the internet. District Court Judge Gray Hampton Miller in Houston, Texas, has granted their prayer for relief, although the ruling was declaratory rather than injunctive. Now, this issue and this double standard when it comes to who should register for a potential draft or who should be conscripted in a future war was one of the issues that made me dig deeper into this gender equality debate and discussion. That was back in 2014, which means women had long time ago earned their right to vote, even though in countries with conscription or a military registry, they didn't have to register or be conscripted. Now, this always stuck out to me as a horrible double standard. After all, men have to spend months, possibly up to 2 years, in the military while women can do whatever they want with their lives. Go to university, go to work, get married, etc. Cut to 2014, when I legitimately started following both MRAs and feminists online and communicating with them, kind of trying to gauge their opinion on this particular issue, among others. Surprise, surprise, the feminists almost unanimously dismissed my argument that this was discrimination against men that caused this. While the MRAs, of course, said, yes, this is discrimination against men, and this is one of the primary issues that we're fighting. The Selective Service case, though, proves that the insidious argument that it all stems from discrimination against women is in fact false. Reading from the NCFM's first complaint for declaratory and injunctive relief filed in April of 2013, link in the description. The above referenced discriminatory laws and policies violate the rights of plaintiffs and other qualifying men in the United States under the 5th and 14th Amendment of the United States Constitution and United States Code. Men failing to register with the Selective Service System can be fined up to $250,000, sentenced to 5 years in prison, and can be disqualified from a number of federal and state benefits, including jobs, financial aid, citizenship, and job training. Now, if this doesn't sound like legal discrimination against a group of people, in this case, men, I don't know what does. Interestingly enough, Judge Ray Miller agreed with an NCFM and Mark Angelucci and declared that it is indeed a violation of men's rights. Quoting from the conclusion from the final 2019 ruling, the final ruling that came down this year, defendant's motion to stay and motion for summary judgment is denied. Defendants means Selective Service. Although plaintiff's complaint requests injunctive relief, plaintiffs have not briefed the issue and their summary judgment motion only request declaratory relief. Plaintiffs means NCFM. Therefore, plaintiff's request for an injunction is denied. Plaintiff's motion for summary judgment is granted. Mark Angelucci also explains it like this in this video clip.
Your Honors, I have to sometimes restrain myself when I hear anybody say that there is no harm going on when somebody is forced to be an on-call warrior for the state because of their gender. Now, in this situation, we're not just talking about equal protection. Men are subjected to fines, prison. Men are can't get federal jobs. They can't get federal loans. And in Elgin versus Bush, we've seen where men actually did lose their federal jobs.
Well, you don't have any plaintiff who didn't register. No. At least you don't say you do.
I'm sorry?
But you mean if they didn't register?
In the Elgin versus Bush case that we cited in our briefs, there were men who lost their federal jobs years later in life because they hadn't registered when they were young. One of them was homeless.
But you don't allege that you have any members who, although subject to the requirement, are refusing to register because they don't.
That's correct. But let's also look at what happens. It's not just that they've registered. They have to continuously report their whereabouts, where their residence is, to the government for 6 years. That's not just a matter of registering. To suggest that Lesmeister doesn't have standing just because he's already registered completely ignores that fact, that he has to continuously report. And in fact, the lower courts in the Roster case acknowledged that, and they completely threw out the argument that there was no ripeness.
It seems to me that this completely disproves the feminist argument that this problem is a product of male privilege backfiring on men. After all, women didn't have problems with having the right to vote without the draft, and that was how men got the vote. Now imagine one of these huge intersectional feminists, you know, not just on YouTube, but let's say, you know, H. Balmer Guy or Pontracoins or PhilosophyTube, saying to the judge, "Actually, Judge Miller, it's all male privilege backfiring on men. So you can't declare this is unconstitutional and that it violates men's equal rights protection clause." Can you imagine the mental gymnastics that feminists in general, or you know, the general public, have to perform to convince themselves that a male-only draft, in an age of equality where women can enjoy full citizenship and have more rights than men, does not affect men negatively? I mean, as I said, in some countries like South Korea, only males have to serve for 22 months. Yet if you ask feminists, they will continue to insist that this does not stem from discrimination against males or perceived male disposability or anything like that. It's just male privilege backfiring on men, and women have nothing to gain by enjoying the privileges of citizenship for free. The gall they have. Fortunately, MRAs have not fallen for this lie, and as a result, we have a ruling from a district court judge that agrees with this. The main point, you know, of this video today is that men have a lot more hurdles to overcome. Just a few examples. Male genital mutilation, where we have a horrible double standard against males, sentencing disparity, unequal pension age, male homelessness, and I can go on and on. I want you to know that all of these issues, when it comes to dealing with them, will be blamed by the mainstream and by feminists on male privilege or the patriarchy backfiring on men. Well, I'm here to say that this argument is completely invalid and should never stop any man from fighting for his legal equal rights. This argument is pure gaslighting and needs to be put to bed once and for all. Men face legal discrimination, and if people have a problem with men fighting for their rights, then they are on the wrong side of history. Why is that every other group of people can fight for their rights but not men? Maybe it has to do with misandry and male disposability. I don't know. In conclusion, I would like to say that this should be just the beginning of men fighting for their rights and standing up for themselves. Misandry is only going to get worse both culturally and legally, So men need to wake up from their comatose state and demand that they be treated as equal human beings and equal citizens. I hope we can see more victories like this in the future. Thank you for listening and have a pro-male day.